we've gone all through, up through Article 29, and we've touched on several articles in the 30s. One which we ought to pay attention to is Article 30, which is called, which is entitled Freedom of Speech, but again, it has no title because it's never been amended.
What is this, the New Hampshire Constitution?
New Hampshire Constitution, yeah.
And this is for the legislature?
This is Article 30, well, refers to the legislature. That's important because until the 1960s, there was no general recognized freedom of speech. Article 22, which now says free speech, originally referred to only liberty of the press. So we had no general free speech recognized like we have in our First Amendment. What was considered free speech was freedom of deliberation, speech, and debate in either house of the legislature is so essential to the rights of the people that it cannot be the foundation of any action, complaint, or prosecution in any other court or place whatsoever. Now there's again, you read our Constitution, and there's always little funny little things wrapped up into the way they put things. First of all, we see that the idea of debate in the legislature is sacrosanct. So the motions to limit debate are always somewhat troubling. And they happen fairly frequently, several times each session. I never support them. But beyond that, look at how it's phrased at the end, that what's said in the legislature cannot be the foundation of any action, complaint, or prosecution in any other court or place whatsoever. What does that say about the legislature, termed the general court? It acknowledges that we are a court of certain jurisdiction. Now remember when we talked earlier, we talked about Article 19, which talks about, Article 17, which talks about venues for criminal prosecution, clearly puts the criminal actions of the state against an individual into the judiciary. And then Article 20, which guarantees a right to trial by jury in civil causes between two or more persons, a jury trial clearly puts the litigation of civil suits before the judiciary. But now we're going to travel into another realm. And this is actually what the legislature was most involved in during the first 35 years of its existence. Now, Article 31, again, no title. The legislature shall assemble for the redress of public grievances and for the making of such laws as the public good may require. So the first purpose for which we convene is to redress public grievances. And the understanding of the people who wrote that, because it's what they did, was when somebody was injured by a member of government or by the government itself in some way, the place they complained to was the legislature. And in fact, Article 7 of Part 2 was a direct reaction to some of the practices, early practices, during the first 8 years of our republic. Article 7 says, no member of the general court shall take fees, be of counsel, or act as an advocate in any cause before either branch of the legislature. And upon due proof thereof, such member shall forfeit his seat in the legislature. That's because members of the legislature were taking fees for introducing petitions for redress. So this clearly speaks as to what was happening at the time of our founding. Now what happened was, and these are some typical events, a road was made and after a storm washed out into a farmer's field, and the field had to be repaired. He entered a petition for redress before the legislature, and the legislature made good upon the repair of his field. We have a number of individuals who funded campaigns during the War for Independence, and having not been repaid, made a petition to the legislature to be repaid for what they invested in the War for Independence, and were made whole. Typically, what would happen is, instead of just making laws, what we would do is we would find out about deficiencies in the law by a petition for redress. And hearing the details of the redress, instead of the people trying to make their problems fit the laws we were proposing laws to fit the problems of the people.
But that implies that there were laws already before the Constitution.
There were. All the laws, the whole body of law, colonial law, that existed before the Constitution, unless it was in fact repugnant to the Constitution, was carried forward. So all of our colonial statutes just carried forward.
Was anything in the common law ever considered repugnant to the Constitution?
No, common law is fundamentally accepted as constitutional. But then we also made a number of statutes. We had statutes as to, before the War for Independence, we had statutes as to what the size of a loaf of bread had to be for commercial sale.
Where did they come from? England?
No, we passed them here in our legislature.
What?
In order to ensure people wouldn't be ripped off for buying a small loaf of bread, we made a statutory requirement for what a loaf of bread was.
Regardless of whether they wanted a small loaf of bread or not.
Well, I was just sort of,
that's besides the point.
Was this something that had sort of got carried over and they realized you had to have it here?
No, these were most of the laws which affected the people of New Hampshire were made in New Hampshire. All the states had colonial legislatures in concert with their respective royal governors. And they made their laws. Yet you have to understand how America grew up. People don't, it's hard to imagine, but it's 1620 and the Pilgrims land in Plymouth and start the Massachusetts Bay Colony. New Hampshire was separated from that in about 1628, and then in the 1630s petitioned to be rejoined because we just didn't have a big enough population, we didn't have critical mass. And then in 1650 we were separated out again.
But how many people were in New Hampshire then?
Several thousand. But think about what was going on in England at the same time that the colonies were growing. What was happening in England between 1625 and 1640, and then continued until 1650?
Is there a battle between the English naval supremacy and that of the Spanish?
No, it was Cromwell in the English Civil War. They weren't paying any attention to us because they were fighting each other. So we had to take care of ourselves. We developed our own legislatures and we learned to take care of our own business. And by the time Cromwell gives the governance of England back to the royal lineage in 1650 or 55, we have an established body of law, an established order of governing ourselves. And that just continued, and that's
what?
Yeah, that's why we developed this attitude of self-reliance. The mother country had nothing to do with this. They were fighting themselves.
Yeah, between 1620, when the Pilgrims came over, I guess, 35 years later, a hell of a lot of people came over.
That's right. They were fleeing the Civil War in England.
But before the Pilgrims came, there wasn't much interest in the United States. There was
a lot of interest. There had been probably 50 years of commerce over here because they were coming over here to catch fish. There were no formal colonies. There were fishing villages.
So there already were.
Isles of Shoals have been semi-inhabited for a long time.
By Europeans?
By Europeans, oh, yes. When the Pilgrims and the James Colony came over here, they weren't wandering around. They knew exactly where they were going.
But, and yet, they still got lost, didn't they?
They got blown off course.
Okay.
That's a different story.
All right.
They were heading for Hudson Bay and got blown north.
Well, because the Puritans came to Boston, didn't they?
Puritans are a later development. They're 1630s and onward. And the Pilgrims were Puritans, but they weren't those Puritans.
So when were the first European settlers in, let's say, New England or America? Or
the first established colonies were the Pilgrims and Jamestown.
There were a lot of little.
They were just fishermen knew where to land, where they could clean their ships and make their nets and all that kind of stuff. European trappers, the French were doing their thing up in Canada, and the Spanish had been colonizing the Southwest for a long time. But let's get back on track here. Yes, I did.
I remember checking the fingers too.
First things first.
Okay, that's less legitimate. But let's get back to, so the legislature, the first order of business for the legislature was the redress of public grievances. And these public grievances were when somebody had been injured by government. So not a case of the state against an individual, not a case of one individual against another, but a case of an individual against the state. And whether it be state, county, or local. Because our cities and towns, we're not Massachusetts, we're not a commonwealth where the sovereignty lies with the locale and the state is an aggregate. We are a state divided into political subdivisions.
Dan?
Yes.
So individual as plaintiff. Right.
Yes.
Got it.
Okay. Now, Article 32 then speaks to the idea of redress of grievances more particularly. Article 32 says the people have a right in an orderly and peaceful manner to assemble and consult upon the common good, to give instructions to their representatives, and to request the legislative body by way of petition or remonstrance, which is spoken word, redress of the wrongs done them and the grievances they suffer. So you have a positive right as a citizen to have the injury done you by the state or any of its political subdivisions heard by the legislature. And this was the primary business of the legislature for the first 35 years of our state. Most legislation came in as a result of a petition for redress. And the most frequent object of redress was the judiciary, typically for loss of due process. We have a catalog in the archives of petitions for redress. One, for instance, is a woman by the name of McClary, and she had a relative die. And she was in England at the time of the passing. And the probate court heard the case and gave the estate to an individual, not her. She comes back from England, says, hey, the will says it was supposed to go to me. I wasn't properly noticed of the hearing. And she entered a petition for redress. And the legislature basically said, do over. They never took the position of reversing a decision, but if there was a loss of due process, they would order what we would now call a de novo trial.
You say petition resulted in legislation.
Yes.
How much of that, how much of the legislation was to say the government okay from now on? Or what kind of legislation?
It may, I don't have good particulars, it may have been...
Repeat the question, please.
Okay, the question was, what was the resulting legislation from petitions for redress? That's an accurate summation. And it could have been to order a repayment of money to an individual. It could have been a change to a statute to clarify the law. It could have been an order to the judiciary to do the trial over of some sort.
So a lot of those statutes were one-time deals addressing particular.
Yes, and those and we still have a lot of I wouldn't say a lot. We still use that vehicle occasionally. You have two kinds of law. You have every bill we pass or resolution is what's called session law.
Session?
Session law, and it lives in the records of the session. Then a certain amount of that is also, and session law is resolutions, like a House resolution or a Senate resolution, a concurrent resolution, which is a combined resolution of the two bodies, a joint resolution, which goes to the governor for signature, or a concurrent resolution, a constitutional amendment concurrent resolution. None of those end up in our book of statutes. Things that are introduced as bills end up in our book of statutes. And we don't really pay good attention to the separation between the two. For instance, if we are telling the Attorney General to prosecute a case and we did this back in 96, we passed a bill telling the Attorney General to try and get CV Island back, where the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard is, because it used to be part of New Hampshire. And the Attorney General did that. That's actually sitting there in statute. That's when I was chairman of the Committee on Constitutional Review and Statutory Recodification. That was one of the laws we tried to get out of the statute books, because why have it there? It's already passed. The time has passed, the suit was lost. It doesn't need to be inflating the book of statutes. It's something that really ought to have been pushed, passed as a joint resolution, having, say, it started in the House, gone to the Senate, and then to the governor. It's an inappropriate use of legislation. Statute books are generally reserved for things that affect the public, the creation of departments, laws that control punishments for certain crimes. Those are things that belong in the statute books. Laws that order a member of the executive or the judiciary to commit a certain act have no necessity to be in the statutes. They don't affect the general public. Now, petitions.
Call them laws or what?
Yeah, they're called session law as opposed to statute law.
When I hear things that say law, it may or may not be the same thing.
Correct. There are all kinds of law.
Are they, that distinction that you're making, is that a, are they both still RSAs?
No. Only statutes are RSAs.
Okay.
Revised statutes annotated.
Yes.
Session law is not in the RSAs. However, the law requiring the then Attorney General to prosecute the case against Maine is in the RSAs. And that's something that has no need to be there. Now, what I told you about petitions for redress, that was the state of things from 1785 until 1818. Approximately the first 35 years of our republic. And then there was a lawsuit. Dorothy Merrill versus Administrix versus Joseph Sherburne and everybody else in concern. And this was a case of an apparent loss of due process. And in Merrill versus Sherburne, the judiciary found that the process of redress of grievances had been being used inappropriately. Now, 1818, 1819, we discussed this a little bit before, is a very important period because it really speaks of when the founding fathers were exiting the scene. A good example is John Langdon. He was Speaker of the House during the war years, became one of the first presidents, became one of our first two senators, came back, was a state senator again, and then a governor. 1812, he retires from government. 1819, he dies. Now, it's not particularly singularly significant that he died, but it speaks of what's happening. The other thing that happened at the same time, in 1816, the legislature passed from the Federalists to the Anti-Federalists. And in 1818, it passed from the Anti-Federalists back to the Federalists. And that's two election cycles, okay, because elections were annual. So by the time you get to 1818, there's nobody in government who remembers the way things used to be. There's nobody there who was there at the founding. You've really lost all institutional memory in the body. And the judiciary, whether intended or not, comes up with their decision, their opinion on Merrill versus Sherburne. And in their opinion, whenever I have found the judiciary to be doing something that I consider questionable, shall we say, there is a pattern. And out of the 10 pages of Merrill versus Sherburne, you have a very long buildup, about 5 pages of buildup. The entire argument is in one paragraph and then another 4 pages of conclusions. Talking to a friend of mine, now retired, but a private investigator, former police investigator, it is typical when somebody is offering false testimony that they do a lot of hand waving. We get down to what I call the fulcrum argument. And this is what they have to say. And I've got here another important resource because it is really what they pin everything on. This is Madison's Federalist Paper 47. So, it is well known and considered that in the distinct and separate existence of the judicial power consists of one main perspective of the public liberty. That indeed there is no liberty if the power of judging be not separated from the legislative and executive powers. And that is referenced to Montesquieu as a complete quote. That's in quotes. In other words, that the union of these two powers, that quote, the union of these two powers is tyranny. Johnson, I don't know who Johnson is, a law case. And in the word, or in the language of Mr. Jefferson, I'm sorry, 18, word reference 18, I'm sorry, or as Mr. Madison observes, may be justly pronounced the very definition of tyranny. So the judiciary has led you to understand that Madison says that putting the legislative under, I'm sorry, putting the judiciary under any scrutiny of the legislative or executive branches is the very definition of tyranny. And that this is really, and that the foundation for this argument is in Montesquieu. So let's see what Mr. Madison says. Now remember, what they said was when the judiciary is under any scrutiny from the other two branches. So, let me just find this. The accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary, in the same set of hands, whether of one, a few, or many, whether hereditary, self-appointed, or elective, may be justly pronounced the very definition of tyranny. So did they quote Madison correctly?
No.
No. They took a sentence fragment, they quoted a sentence fragment rather than a whole sentence.
Skew the definition.
To skew the definition of what Madison said. And what Madison was really arguing against there was the Articles of Confederation, where all three powers of government rested in the Congress. The Congress was the legislative, the president of the Congress was the president of the Union, and select members of the Congress were the judiciary. So he wasn't arguing, as our Supreme Court said, but, or actually the Superior Court. But Madison, in the same paragraph, goes on to talk about Montesquieu. The oracle who is always consulted and cited on this subject is the celebrated Montesquieu. If he be not the author of this invaluable precept in the science of politics, he has the merit at least of displaying and recommending it most effectually to the attention of mankind. Let us endeavor in the first place to ascertain his meaning on this point. The British Constitution was to Montesquieu what Homer has been to the dyadic writers of epic poetry. So Montesquieu's ideal is the British Constitution. As the latter have considered the work of the immortal bard as a perfect model from which the principles and rules of epic art are to be drawn, and by which all similar works are to be judged, so this great political critic appears to have viewed the Constitution of England as the standard, or to use his own expression, as the mirror of public political liberty, and to deliver it in the form of the elementary truths, the several characteristics of principles of that particular system, that we may be sure then not to mistake his meaning in this case. Let us recur to the source from which the maxim was drawn. So now he goes on to quote Montesquieu. On the slightest view of the British Constitution, we must perceive the legislative, executive, and judicial departments, always in the same order, are by no means totally separate and distinct from each other. Is that what our Supreme Court found? The executive magistrate forms an integral part of the legislative authority. He alone has the prerogative of making treaties with foreign sovereigns, which, when made, have under certain limitations, the force of legislative acts. All the members of the judiciary department are appointed by him and can be removed by him on the address of two houses of parliament. And the form when he pleases to consult them, one of his constitutional councils. One branch of the legislative department also forms a great constitutional council to the chief executive chief, as on the other hand, is the sole depository of such judicial power in the cases of impeachment, and is vested in the supreme appellate jurisdiction in all other cases. So under the British model, which Montesquieu considers the ideal, the legislature was the final court of appeals.
Yeah. A general question.
Yes.
There's references back to England.
Yes.
And yet they're trying to be different for some reason. Was there a strong feeling that, I'm stealing from you.
That's okay.
Okay. Was there a strong feeling that they liked the British model, or they had so many problems with it that they were trying to construct a new model?
Yes. The answer to both questions, the answer to that question is yes. They had problems with certain parts of it. They did not like the idea of a king. They did not like any idea of hereditary rule, which the House of Lords was and still is a hereditary house.
Yes.
On the other hand, they generally considered the British model of a constitutional monarchy to be the best there was at the time. They wanted to take it a rung further.
Really was about the only model of a reasonable democracy, or what you want to call it.
That's true. So let's look at that fulcrum argument again. Okay? They attribute the idea of that indeed there is no liberty if the power of judging be not separated from the legislative and executive powers, as a quote from Montesquieu. But we hear, see Montesquieu saying that the English model, in which the legislature is involved in and is the final court of appeal, is the ideal. And then they go on to say, as Mr. Madison observes, may be justly pronounced the very definition of tyranny, but he is not talking of partial agency. Montesquieu likes partial agency. What Madison is arguing against is total agency, when all three powers rest in one set of hands, not when they have interaction.
Question.
Yes.
Does Madison also mean that it's de facto tyranny when all three sets of powers reside in the same deliberative body, or just the same set of hands?
The deliberative body.
Deliberative body.
Right.
Okay. So he seems to be at loggerheads with Montesquieu, at least in part. Am I right?
Did you say at loggerheads?
No, because
the legislature did not hold the complete judicial power. They held the powers of impeachment and bill of address, and they held the power of being the final court of appeals, but they did not hold the whole power. Montesquieu likes partial agency because it gives the branches the power to keep the other in check.
Mutually regulated.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, then I'm going to jump to the conclusion of this law case. I gotta just find the quote here.
What year are we talking about here?
1819. There we go. The long usage of our legislature to grant new trials has also been deemed an argument in favor of the act under consideration. But the usage commenced under colonial institutions where the legislative powers were neither understood nor limited as under our present constitution. Since the adoption of that, the usage has been resisted by sound civilians and often declared void by courts of law, which is not true. What they said was that the people who wrote the Constitution, ratified the Constitution, and practiced the Constitution for the first 35 years didn't understand what they had created. And it took this group of individuals who had no connection with the original intent to properly understand it. After that time, and we had a legislature that had had a double exchange, no founding fathers present any longer, so there was nobody to stand up and say, hold it, which is very important. At that point, they surrendered their power of public redress regarding the judiciary to the judiciary. After that time, because the judiciary being in the business tends to be more timely than the legislature, the judiciary started taking up ordinary cases of people versus the state. And the people getting their satisfaction more quickly tended to use the judiciary. But our Constitution...
And the state abided by the
decision? Yep. Though they shouldn't have, and there is in fact no requirement for them to. How does money come out of the treasury? By the hand of the governor, agreeably to the acts of the legislature. So if a court finds against the state in a civil suit, you know, a suit of an individual against the state, and says, you know, New Hampshire, you owe John Jones $50,000. That's the settlement.
That's what?
That's the settlement, okay? That's been arrived to in a court of law. Does that obligate any money out of the treasury? It can't, because there's been no legislative act to appropriate that money. And if we choose not to, bumpkiss.
Now, isn't that something we heard lately, that there's some fund, some fees, and...
So, now, this goes back to the fundamental soundness of the original design. If you have been injured by the state, and you're seeking redress, and you need a change to the law, or you need remuneration for your injury, who has the power to make that act?
The general court.
The general court. So who should you go before? The general court. The judiciary has no power to actually make you whole. We have a contest going on right now. We passed a law of school funding, and we had a formula, but then we said no town could receive more than 8% more than what they'd received during the last year. So their school funding, the increase in their school funding, if there was one, was capped. And a court case out of Dover. Dover sued the state. The judiciary found, it's only been a superior court thus far, the judiciary found that the cap was unconstitutional. Okay, good. Where does the money come from?
Governor Hassan.
She has to find it from someplace. Where does the money come from? Money can only come from us. We have to appropriate it. One of the things I'm waiting to see is, how is this judgment going to be satisfied? Is the Department of Ed just going to shift money around? I don't know.
That depends on how much of a shitstorm they want to stir up.
Oh yeah.
Well, if the Department of Ed wants to, or the governor or whatever, whoever, wants to shift money around, that the general court said, here's your money to spend for this, but the general court didn't say it was to spend for that court case.
Agreeably to the acts and resolves of the legislature. That's the final clause in Article 56, Part 2. If we didn't make an act or resolve to which that action is agreeable, it is unconstitutional.
It would be unconstitutional for anyone to spend that money.
Correct.
Yes. Yes. Because we have to say it's okay.
Yes.
But if the judiciary says it's unconstitutional, can they take the legislator to court?
No. What did we see in Article 30? No speech or deliberation during debate or vote resulting therefrom, presumably, can be cause for action in any other court. What are they going to do? Jail the legislature for contempt of court? Good luck.
Sometimes a court might say something that's really off the wall, but if nobody calls them on it, then that off the wall becomes precedent.
Like Merrill versus Sherbert.
If the court says to the state, pay this money to Dover,
and nobody says no,
and somebody pays that money to Dover, and there isn't a shite storm started because of that, then that becomes a precedent that if the court tells you to pay, somebody just go pay it.
Right. Which has not happened yet. Claremont 1 and 2 dealt with requiring the state to define an adequate education and fund it. So we defined it and then we funded it. Nobody has ordered the state to pay money. Closest we came, and we sort of half won that, we lost it in the end, but only because we were stupid, was when during 2002 and 2006, when the judiciary mucked with the elections. In 2002, they told the Secretary of State not to use the districts that we had established by law. Yes.
So the judiciary branch has not ordered the executive branch pay money, but it has ordered the legislative branch to change law so that the executive branch would pay money.
Correct.
Okay. Just want to sort that out.
Did the judicial branch delineate where the money is coming from and where henceforth that money would be sequestered for future actions that were similar?
Have no idea. Gee, I think maybe we should have a resolution to investigate this during the next session, don't you?
Imagine that, yes. If hypothetically, let me build on that last question, if I may. If hypothetically there were a fund of some sort that had been identified, labeled, and sequestered for the purpose of remunerating those who had been found deserving of a judgment against the state and deserving of some kind of remuneration, would that not necessarily create an unintended consequence, which would be a potential avalanche of redress of grievance cases that would be brought forward? Oh, look, there's a fund. Let's see what we can get out of it. Is that a potential unintended consequence?
I would not call them redress of grievances. I would call them civil suits against the state.
Civil suits against the state.
One would presume so.
One would presume so. How do we navigate that then, given the fact that redress is a good thing?
We force the system to act constitutionally and not unconstitutionally.
If we did, where's the money coming? Or am I getting ahead of it?
You're getting ahead of it. I mean, okay. The legislature would have to decide whether that was in fact unconstitutional. And if go back to the case, and you weren't here for the discussion, the 10-pound act. Our Constitution said you had the right to trial by jury, no equivocation, originally in Article 20, no $1,500 limit or anything. And the legislature, because of the economic times in the 1880s, said, gee, if it's less than 10 pounds, you can go to your local justice of the peace and get satisfaction. This was happening, and during one of the adjudications, the defendant's attorney stood up and said, it's unconstitutional, Article 20. My client was due a right to trial by jury in the first instance. And the judge found in favor of the defendant and then arrested his decision. And this continued for 18 months. But there was no presumption that the judiciary finding a law unconstitutional nullified the law. The law was still there on the books. Cases were still executed under that law, or prosecuted under that law. But then, in a preponderance of cases, somebody stood up and said it's unconstitutional, and the judge in the case said, you're right, and made the decision, then arrested their decision. This made the legislature very angry. After 18 months, they attempted to impeach the judges. Failing to impeach the judges, they repealed the law. That's proper constitutional interplay.
Sure. Sure.
Okay. So, in this case, the proper constitutional interplay is if the people have a problem with the constitutionality of a law we pass, someone should enter a petition for redress before the legislature and discuss the unconstitutionality directly with the legislature. And then we can decide whether they're right or wrong. We have a case of Jeff Frost, who has been an occasional candidate for the legislature since, where the in the wake of the FRM scandal, they became hyper-vigilant and began, attempted to enforce the law retrospectively. And in an instance which it wouldn't have applied anyway because the individual was not making commercial loans, he was writing a mortgage on the sale of his own property, which has always been traditionally accepted in New Hampshire. The banking commissioner and the attorney general prosecuted the case. Fortunately, the judge in the case said, this is ex post facto or retrospective law, no. The state lost the case. The attorney general then appealed it to Supreme Court, went to Supreme Court. Supreme Court said, no, this is retrospective law and it doesn't apply anyway. And Mr. Frost never had to go to jail. But it cost him $180,000. He has, in 2012, a petition for redress was entered on his behalf, in which the $180,000 was sought for having to defend him against himself repeatedly against the state for retrospective and misapplication of law. The legislature determined that he was right. In 2013 and 2015, legislation has been introduced to make him whole. The legislature has refused it. However, he now has a judgment from a court of law that says this should be handled by the... He attempted then to bring suit before the judiciary regarding it, and the judiciary refused it and said this should go before the legislature.
Was that the legislature's position, that it wasn't its jurisdiction?
No, they just didn't want to spend the money.
They didn't want to set the precedent that redress grievances.
But they also did not want to set the precedent that redress grievances resulted in redress.
And ought to be directed towards the legislature uniformly.
But this is really fundamental to the construction of our state.
So what is the method if you decide your legislatures are not upholding the law to a recall election? Can you do that? Can all the states say, you know what?
We have no provision for that in our constitution or in law. We do that every 2 years. Hopefully people have a long enough memory to deal with it.
They don't.
I know. That's one of the reasons our elections used to be annual. They were annual until the 1870s.
Dan, in these kinds of things, you don't hear anything about them in the papers. Quite obviously, most of the legislators don't even know what the hell's going on. Where do these things get resolved?
Where do which things get resolved?
What?
Where do which things get resolved?
These kinds of serious questions, fundamental things about who's going to get this and how things are going to be reimbursed, and things are legal and whether the judiciary has done, the proper thing.
Well, they get resolved amongst the legislators. During Bill O'Brien's term, we had a committee on redress of grievances. Unfortunately, the people, for whatever reason, did not elect a body that would continue the same administration, and having just gotten our feet wet, the rug was pulled.
And the Committee for Redress of Grievances held public hearings.
Correct.
Whereas now, these discussions are held in back rooms.
Correct. I mean, one of the important things, and this was something I observed, although I would say we are still not, I question whether it can happen, but I don't know that the moment is lost completely yet. Remember I spoke to you about the exchange in the legislature. And in the wake of the exchange of the legislature, the people lost their right of redress against the judiciary. 1773 and 1775, there were also exchanges of the legislature. In the wake of that, the people lost their right to jury in new types of civil cases. Same kind of hand-waving, terrible judicial opinion. But the moral of the story is not that when there's these exchanges of the legislature that bad things happen, though they can. The moral to the story is that when you have exchanges to the legislature, you can change the political paradigm. That was what we began in 2011. 2007, the legislature flips from Republican to Democrat. Two election cycles later, just like previously, we changed from Democrat back to Republican. We began to change the paradigm. Next election, it goes back to Democrat. Now we've gone back to Republican.
Barely.
Sort of.
Ish.
Maybe.
So we're in a paradigm where we can change the, we are in a situation where we can change the paradigm of government if we can hold it long enough.
There was a similar loss of legislative branch authority at the federal level. I believe in Madison.
Yes.
What is the temporal relationship between that federal loss and the similar state laws? What are they related?
I think they're related, if only in the fact that the people involved in the founding of government, or in the founding of our government, were no longer involved. You had handed the torch of liberty to the next generation, and the principles had not been adequately transmitted.
But I guess I'm asking, was maybe not overtly, but in those backroom dealings, was it just, well, you know what we can do now, the feds have said, so we can do the same thing.
Well, and there's been a 200-year march of accretion of power in the judiciary. It's been slow, steady, and I don't believe accidental. Now, in talking about the separation of powers, Madison goes on in 47, Federalist Paper 47. It's a great, great piece of work. And that quote from Montesquieu, if the power of judging be not separated from the legislative and executive powers, he did not mean that these departments ought to have no partial agency in or no control over the acts of the other. His meaning was, as his own words import, and still more conclusively as illustrated by the example in his eye, can amount to no more than this, that the whole power of one department is exercised, that where the whole power of one department is exercised by the same hands, which possess the whole power of another department, the whole's being capitalized, all caps, the fundamental principles of free constitution is subverted. So Montesquieu was not arguing against partial agency, and Madison was not arguing against partial agency, and that is what our judiciary used to steal the power of redress from the people. But we go on. Because one of the things that Madison goes on to discuss is separation of powers. That's what this is actually all about. And you might think that, well, maybe he didn't know what was going on in the states, particularly in New Hampshire. But, again, were the power of judging joined with the legislative, the life and liberty of the subject would be exposed to arbitrary control. The judge would then be the legislator. Boy, does that sound familiar. The judge would then be the legislator. Were it joined to the executive power, the judge might have behaved with all the violence of an oppressor. Some of these reasons are more fully explained in other passages, but briefly stated as they are here, they are sufficiently established by the established meaning which we have put on the celebrated maxim of this celebrated author. If we look into the constitutions of the several states, we find that notwithstanding the emphatical and in some instances, the unqualified terms of which this axiom has been laid down. So he's saying in most of the state constitutions, they prescribe an absolute and total separation of power. There is not one single instance in which the several departments of the power have been kept absolutely separate and distinct. In New Hampshire, whose constitution was the last formed, that's important, I've discussed that in this class before, ours is retrospective of all the other state constitutions, last formed seems to have been fully aware of the impossibility and inexpediency of avoiding any mixture, whatever, of these departments, and has qualified the doctrine by declaring that the legislative and executive and judiciary powers ought to be kept as separate from and independent of each other as, and now in all caps by Madison, as the nature of a free government will admit, or is consistent with that chain of connection that binds the whole fabric of the Constitution in one indissoluble bond of unity and amity, close quote. Her Constitution, accordingly mixes these departments in several respects. The Senate, which is the branch of the legislative department, is also the judicial tribunal in the trial of impeachments. The President, who is the head of the executive department, is the presiding member also in the Senate. This is the 1784 Constitution that was separated in 1792. And besides, an equal vote in all cases as casting a vote in the case of a tie. The executive head himself is equally elected every year by the legislative department. And his counsel is chosen every year by and from members of the same department. The executive council was originally 3 members of the House and 2 members of the Senate, chosen by the legislature. And as the members and several of the officers of this state are also appointed by the legislature, Secretary of State and Treasurer, and they still are. And the members of the Judiciary Department are appointed by the Executive Department. The Constitution of Massachusetts, okay, and then he goes out of Massachusetts. So he knew what our Constitution said. And we can presume from that that he knew what the practice of law was. And he knew that there was, probably knew that there was petition for redress. And he did not find it repugnant to liberty. Now let's go on to Article 35. We discussed Article 33, which is excessive bails and fines. We discussed Article 34, which is martial law limited. Only the legislature can declare martial law. Article 35, again, coined, titled the judiciary, tenure of officers, etc. But again, no title exists. So don't be limited by it. It is essential to the preservation of the rights of every individual, his life, liberty, property, and character, that there be an impartial interpretation of the laws and administration of justice. It is the right of every citizen to be tried by judges as impartial as the lot of humanity will admit. It is therefore not only the best policy, but for the security and the rights of the people, that the judges of the Supreme Judicial Court should hold their offices so long as they behave well, subject to, however, to such limitations on account of age, or part two, as may be provided by the Constitution of the state, that they should have honorable salaries ascertained and established by standing laws. So, this clearly says that the judiciary has a job of impartial interpretation of the laws. What is included in that term, laws? Anybody want to hazard a guess?
Who wouldn't dare? Injustice.
It's interpretation of the law. The law is designed to mitigate or punish injustice. When they said that the judiciary had the job of impartial interpretation of the laws, what does laws include?
Common practice.
It includes the statutes and common law. What does it not include?
Okay, so that's it.
What does it not include?
The Constitution.
The Constitution. Because if you look at the word laws, it appears 23 times in part one, and 25 times in part two. In every other instance, the appearance of the word laws is either implicitly or explicitly laws pursuant to the Constitution.
So what does the Constitution consider itself?
The Constitution. And you will notice.
But that's a proper noun.
Correct.
What's a descriptor for the Constitution?
There is none given. Right. It is the Constitution.
But is that different from federal or is it Supreme Law?
Yes. This is New Hampshire. We're talking about our Constitution, yeah. Our laws.
But everybody says this is New Hampshire.
Well, but it's an important thing. And if you notice that in the next 2 sentences later, when they mean Constitution, they say Constitution, and in the same sentence, they refer to the laws. Okay? On account of age, as may be provided by the Constitution of the state, and that they should have honorable salaries and ascertained and established by standing laws. So laws means laws, constitution means constitution. There is no power, you know, a lawyer will tell you, well, the constitution is the supreme law of the land. Our constitution does not designate itself that way. It is simply designated the constitution. And so when Article 35 gives the judges the power to interpret the law, it's referring, every other instance of the word law refers to laws pursuant to the Constitution. One must assume it's the same word. Now, when you're interpreting the laws, you're inevitably going to be interpreting the Constitution. But the power or the responsibility to interpret the Constitution is in no way unique to the judiciary. The executive has the same responsibility, and so does the legislature. Our laws are, we only have the power to promulgate laws pursuant to the Constitution. Therefore, we must be interpreting the Constitution to make sure we do it correctly, right?
Not necessarily.
But one would presume. And who is the final judge of the Constitution?
The people.
The people. Remember Article 38? A frequent recurrence of the fundamental principles of the Constitution and a constant adherence to justice, moderation, temperance, industry, and frugality, and all the social virtues are indispensably necessary to preserve the blessings of liberty and good government. The people ought, therefore, to have a particular regard to all those principles in the selection of their officers and representatives. And they have a right to require of their lawgivers and magistrates an exact and constant observance of them in the formation and execution of the laws necessary for the good administration of government. It's the people who have the final say on what is constitutional. If this Constitution was written with the expectation that the average person could read and understand it, and that they would then know when the goobers in government were going off the rails, that they needed to replace them.
Doesn't that sound like a pretty specific power of recall?
Every 2 years.
Yeah. Every 2 years is when the people decide what is constitutional.
Well, or if their legislatures behave, or their executive are behaving constitutionally, or if they are making the courts behave constitutionally.
Okay, but as the thing keeps getting longer and longer, it's long past the time that an average person can even know what's in it, let alone interpret it. I mean, we're sitting here, we've been here how many different nights, and we know more about it probably than most, and I gotta say, I wouldn't.
But whose responsibility is it?
Right?
Whose responsibility is it?
Well, what I'm concerned about always and often, the more laws you make, the more difficult it is to know what to do. And therefore, there always should be something in the Constitution that says it can't get any longer than X words.
Well, the Constitution hasn't changed substantially in length.
But you're reading different parts of it.
But it's still all the, there's no substantially new parts. We is probably
well, what are these things that are not new parts?
These are what's been there for 200 since 1784 or 1782. The only
2A was added, for example, a whole new article.
20 words.
But that was 30 years ago.
73A was added, or 72A was added. 73A was added. A number have been deleted. All the articles regarding the ordering of the militia were deleted during the 70s.
Were there any that shouldn't have been?
The articles regarding...
Were there any that shouldn't have been removed?
The articles regarding the ordering of the militia.
Yeah.
But there's not... Our Constitution has not changed in length dramatically over the past 200 years.
Unlike it's been some changed, other states.
It's been changed fairly frequently. Well, I wouldn't say that. It was changed frequently during the early periods. During the 20th century, not much in the last 50 years. hardly at all. I mean, if you just look at the number of articles that actually have changes. Article 27, Part 1, quartery of soldiers, authority was substituting authorities for magistrate. Let's see.
I think 200 years ago, they were that verbose.
Yes. We have. There were more verbose than us. We have a very particular constitution. It is really quite restraining. They did that for a reason. Things that have been inflated. Part 2, Article 5 has been inflated particularly.
And I'd offer that one of the reasons that we've been able to maintain a document that hasn't changed in length all that long is because of something that they left out.
You're talking about
citizens' petitions.
Citizens' petition. We don't have citizens' petitions. And in fact, Massachusetts didn't have citizens' petition originally either. And that was changed in about 1820. I want to say 1824, but I know that's the year that Maine was separated off. But it was in that period that the article, they had the same article for petition of redress that we do. And in the 1820s, that was exchanged for the citizen's petition. And that article for giving citizen's petition particularly says no changes can be made to the judiciary.
It's good to be the king.
That is a specific clause in their citizens' petition article in their constitution.
But you look at others, like Florida, for example, because I know it's there. There's a miscellaneous section in their constitution just for the growing list of shit that the citizens approve to add to their constitution.
The other thing you'll see is in the Western constitutions, they read more like statute than like constitution. Our Bill of Rights is very first principles oriented. This is what government should look like. You don't say anything about the legislature in particular, it's just the legislature, the executive, the judiciary. In Part 2, we have the form of government that gives the specific powers of each branch and tells particularly how they are to interact and gives any, Part 1 says everybody has an equal right to be elected to office. And then Part 2 has a list of particulars of incompatible offices, things that if you violate election law, bribery, or treason, you lose the right to be elected to office. The way I like to describe it is the Bill of Rights is the skeleton and the form of government is the muscles and the statutes put it all into motion.
Well, Bill of Rights is part first. This is what we require now. This is how we're going to implement.
Exactly.
This is barely here at all compared to proposed amendments in California,
there are
thousands of
lawyers.
Yeah, I mean,
they have more lawyers than California.
But the something we didn't touch on? We didn't touch on Part 1, Article 21. So-called privileges of the members of the legislature. No member of the House of Representatives or Senate shall be arrested, held to bail, on mesne process during his going to or returning from his attendance upon the court. Again, the court.
And he can speed and you can't stop.
We cannot be held on mesne process, which is everything that happens before indictment or you know, any dispositive hearing, you can't be held to bail, you can't be put in jail prior to your trial.
You certainly can't be detained.
Okay.
I have a session to get to.
Right. And one of the reasons for that was in certain jurisdictions, they would, if you had a vote coming, they would detain people so they couldn't get to the vote. The interesting thing, and George Lambert has done a good deal of research on this is effectively diplomatic immunity. It derives from the same English law principle as diplomatic immunity. And the legislators are the diplomats from their communities to the government.
Sure.
So you can't deprive the people of their representation on something that hasn't been proven. And nothing is proven until adjudication. So it doesn't keep you from getting the ticket, it keeps you from getting held at the roadside.
You just say, hey, send me a ticket.
Yeah, send me the bill, but let me get to session. Or committee hearing, or committee executive session.
All you will.
The places where you need to be.
Funny that technically the one thing that doesn't apply to would be not yet sworn in members going to be sworn in.
That would probably be, yes, because you're not yet a member.
Nor are you serving in session.
But once you're taking the oath, you're there.
Not going in.
Because, for instance, this is one of the vagaries too. We have no rules until after we've been sworn in. Each new legislature makes its own rules, and we can't even choose to adopt the prior rules as an operating method until we're sworn in, because we're not yet members.
But if you were a member and it was 11:30 at night on a Wednesday or a Thursday, and you were in session, as you were walking out the door, you could just tell the officer, Article 21, I am leaving.
Right.
So you can't delay me.
Correct.
Even if somebody said we're in lockdown.
Lockdown is separate.
That is.
Yes.
Yeah, because you're already there.
Lockdown is in house rules. That's not an issue of mesne process. It's not an issue of being held to bail. And the speaker actually has the power to send the state police to go apprehend you and bring you back. Yes. You can be forced to attend. Because that's where your duty is. That's why you can't be held to bail.
Well, that radical might say that you're saying house rules supersede the Constitution. Because the Constitution...
No, it's very particular. What does it say? No member of the legislature, to shorten it, shall be arrested, held to bail on mesne process during his going to or returning from.
Which would be pursuant to RSAs, not house rules.
So you can't be held to law going to or coming from.
Which does not necessarily absolve you from
consequences. It does not.
Or the consequences associated with it.
Correct.
Yeah.
It just means you can't be.
It's detention.
Yeah, you can't be detained. Actually, that was part two, Article 21.
Yeah.
But it's important. And its origin as an issue of diplomatic immunity is particularly important because it says who you are in the legislature, that you are a diplomat from your community.
That's a silly question.
Yeah.
Is that the deal behind the license plate?
No, I think that's more an issue of tolls. Easy identification. An acute perk. Although it's not a perk as in other states because we still have to pay for our plates. New Hampshire's cheap.
Yep.
Which is how many tolls?
Eight.
Only like a dollar.
Yeah, it's a dollar each way at $8.
Is that it?
Okay. Well, we are fairly well exhausted of part one. The last article is changes in town and city charters, referendum required, which simply boils down to the idea that neither the state nor the local community can change their form of government without the consent of the other. We can't force it on a town, and they can't change it without our permission.
But that's back to the difference between a commonwealth and a...
Correct. So it's an acknowledgement of home rule, but it's also an acknowledgement that they are a political subdivision of the state. They are in essence, a franchise of the state. They're a municipal corporation created by the legislature of New Hampshire. I guess there are some very good things, I would say, in the very beginning of this form of government.
For Article 38, why doesn't that kind of imply a recall? Where it says
because
she's very psyched on this now.
No, I mean, I'm just curious because I mean, it said that they have a right to require.
Right.
I mean, I realize it's every 2 years, but if they don't, why can't they say you can do something about them? If a legislature does not follow the execution of the laws necessary for good administration.
Well, I guess the first thing I would say is remember that this was really designed around a 1 year term.
Why put that in there? I mean, so that they can't say you didn't elect me next.
What's the purpose?
Why didn't you re-elect me?
To remind, just to remind them they don't have to vote for the same person next time.
It's instructive to the citizens that they should know the Constitution and be in requiring their lawgivers and magistrates to adhere to it. Look at the first sentence, and you have to understand what the words mean, because some of them we don't use often anymore. A frequent recurrence to read, study, and discuss. So this kind of discussion should be going on frequently. Everybody should have read the Constitution. Everybody should be able to know when the legislature is doing something unconstitutional or the judiciary. You shouldn't be able to publish, you shouldn't have a newspaper article that says some judge has declared a law unconstitutional and therefore null. And therefore, as a single person, okay, the whole function of our form of government is that we used to be governed largely by what was called common law. And we had a lot of people think that common law is the end all and be all of all law. Common law is what everybody agrees to as law, but it's not written. The deficiency of common law is that it is ultimately up to a single person, the judge. And for that reason, we created statute law. And what we do with statute law is we make uniform punishments, uniform procedures of law. We give everybody the same rules, whether they're in Rockingham County or Coos County. And that's really important, that the penalty for stealing $1,000 is the same in both locales. So what we do is we elect individuals to go make those laws on our behalf. That's 400 people. Hopefully they've been considerate of their constitution when they make those laws. They know what they're doing. How do you have one person being able to take and wipe the product of the people off the books? Is that consistent with self-government? I would say no.
Of course not.
Now, is the opinion of that judge in that instance very instructive? Should be. Especially if a bunch of other judges start making the same opinion. The legislature should start scratching their heads, just like they did with the 10-pound act, 10-pound law. But the you can't have, so when you have a newspaper article that says Judge Sullivan in the Stratford Superior Court has determined that the legislative cap is unconstitutional, and therefore money has to be paid now to 45 communities. It was the last count I saw. The people should be up in arms. They should be asking their state legislators, why aren't you impeaching this turkey? He thinks he can nullify a law that we had you put in place for us. And the idea that, the idea that the people don't know their constitution well enough to know what any branch of government, two years ago, just about exactly, the heroin epidemic was so severe in New Hampshire that Governor Hassan declared a state of emergency and began confiscating stock off the shelves of stores. Is there anything in her emergency powers that authorizes her to do that? These were not illegal products. This was not scheduled drug that wasn't supposed to be sold off the counter. Neither was it any critical supply necessary for the medical treatment of individuals, which is covered. This was private stock. Did anybody complain? But everybody should be looking at this and knowing that they should be up in arms over the fact that only the legislature has the power to suspend habeas corpus. Now, that isn't particularly habeas corpus, but she suspended the due process of law. No one can be deprived of their property but by due process of law. Part 1, Article 12. Part 1, Article 15.
But if we don't, we're supposed to know.
Yes.
We think that the journalists should know.
Yes.
No.
But you should think, that's why we are supposed to have a frequent recurrence of the fundamental, these are Bill of Rights issues, fundamental principles of the Constitution.
I would offer those that we are conditioned, however. Did you see, I haven't read the whole thing, but I saw today or yesterday an article in the Union Leader, I believe, about the DEA now descending on Manchester as a pilot city in the expanded war on the heroin war.
Oh joy.
So the DEA, which is nowhere authorized in the US, the federal constitution, funded nowhere authorized by the federal legislative branch, writing its own, they're not statutes, they're not laws, they're regulations and scheduling, whatever the hell they want, kratom or whatever, and then they say, we're coming into your schools, Manchester, and we are going to be commandeering, or not commandeering, but
confiscating.
What do you do with soldiers? You
appropriate.
No.
It gets worse.
You the they didn't volunteer, they were conscripted, conscripting your parents and your sixth grade students to perpetuate our ridiculously expensive, in blood and treasure, war on people who use some drugs. And there doesn't seem to be anything we can do about it. The federal government has said, this is how you are going to suffer now. And we accept that from our government, whether it's the federal or from the state.
Okay, now, this goes back to Madison. Think about what the DEA is doing. Who wrote the rules? Who wrote the rules?
No, the people.
The DEA wrote the rules.
Oh, those rules.
Okay. Those rules.
Those
rules. The DEA wrote the rules. The DEA is enforcing the rules. Mm-hmm. And where do you think you go when you have violated those rules?
But
do an administrative hearing, administrative judge.
But 1.2 million people in the state of New Hampshire could. You can't string them up because then they can't go back to Mordor on the Potomac. But we could instruct our representatives. They're not. I would maintain they are not our representatives to D.C. They are royal governors from D.C. But we could tell them we've had enough of this shit and we've only got four votes. We can't do anything there.
They're going to close us down, Dan, if this keeps up.
No, they won't. but think about what Madison said. When all three powers of government, to wit, the legislative, executive, and judicial, rest in the same set of hands, whether hereditary, appointed, or elective, this may be termed the very definition of tyranny.
Yes.
And what do you have? You have the creation of the rules, the execution of the rules, and the adjudication of the rules in the same set of hands. And what do you have?
Tyranny.
I'm suffering the same thing from the New Hampshire Department of Health and Human Services.
But that's what I'm saying. We are used to it at the federal level. It's how it's going to be. The DEA is going to take over your city. And most people say that's how government works. It's the price we pay for living in a free society.
That's an oxymoron.
The stormtroopers are coming in here.
So, speaking about Paul Madison, Montesquieu. When you were reading that, I was thinking, what do they mean by scrutiny? Because that sounded like veto.
Scrutiny is oversight, is the best way to put it. Scrutiny can be. Scrutiny can be impeachment, it can be bill of address, it is the interpretation of the laws by the judiciary. Those are all issues of scrutiny.
Right, and it sounded like when you were reading that, he was saying that counts and on the bad side.
No.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think no. He's saying, because, and what he really said conclusively in the last thing I read, is that neither he nor Montesquieu are arguing against partial agency. It's when one power of government exercises the whole power of another part of government. When the legislature is the judiciary, not when they are the court, not when they are the court that hears cases of the people against the state, because they're the only ones that can correct those infractions. But when they are the whole judiciary, or when the judiciary is the whole legislature, and I would say we're getting perilously close to that, when the judiciary does not just interpret the law in that case, but presumes to have the power to nullify the law. And what does Article 29 say? That only the legislature shall execute or suspend any law. Does the judge have any power to suspend the law? As a whole? No. Does he have the power to say, in this case, in my courtroom here before me, I find this law unconstitutional? Yes. Two very different actions.
But I guess my question is, and it goes from state to federal and back again, is that we are conditioned that the state is not
sovereign.
Home rule. No. Within the state. The towns are not sovereign. This is not home rule, this is not a commonwealth, and we are told by the powers that be in the capital what shall happen. And people in New Hampshire anyway, if they're paying any attention
at
all.
I would say we are told what shall not happen.
Okay, fair enough. But so if they're paying any attention at all to the structure of state government, that's what they see. And so the federal government, the general government, becomes by association far less the intended federalist. Even the federalism of the writers of the Federalist Papers, we're not even that anymore. And
not,
so
not by a long shot.
And so the DEA therefore can exist and it can come into your city. And so now we bring that back, and so we're in the state, and that's how the government works. How do we disabuse even New Hampshire's voters sufficiently for them to take whatever action they're actually allowed to take in?
Well, the proper action is, I mean, I always, when talking to people about elections, I always tell people that who they send to Concord is far more important than whom they send to Washington.
Absolutely, though.
Because we have far more legitimate power to mess with their lives, and we are their only defense against Washington.
Yes,
and we're directly accountable to them. They can knock on our doors.
Right, and the point being that in this instance of the DEA presuming the power to come in and conscript the citizens of New Hampshire to rat each other out, it is the legislature who has the proper authority to say no and require the executive to enforce that no.
That's why Ruth has to bid.
Yeah. But again, they have to know their constitution, state constitution in particular.
This has got to be contagious again.
Correct.
I don't care where you are from a partisan standpoint. This has got to become contagious. You've got to make it sexy. You've got to make it interesting, compelling. How do we do that? It's a sales job.
It needs to be required reading for the legislative branch. There was, I don't know whether it was recorded. Dave Ridley might have recorded it, or maybe it was a quote in mainstream media probably 8 years ago.
Yep.
And I'm not gonna reference the party.
Oh, come on.
But there was a sitting representative who said that she didn't really concern herself with constitutionality. That was for the courts to figure out.
I'll bet you
as to passing
no, she was not. She was from Portsmouth.
Yeah.
Worse.
you know who we're referring to? Little old lady from Portsmouth?
Oh, yeah. Who likes to handpick her neighbors.
Yes.
But it requires an informed electorate not to put her in that seat of power.
That is correct.
Obviously.
A frequent recurrence of the fundamental principle. This should be pickle barrel conversation.
But it should be, at some point, the representative has got to have, I don't know what you want to call it, the honor, the intellect, or whatever it is, to turn to their constituent and say, I'm sorry, I don't have the power to do what you're asking. It hasn't been delegated to me.
I do that.
I know you do, but far too few do that. But that's your job.
Absolutely.
Right, but how do you have an informed election? That's the basic problem.
I don't know what's possible. You look at, there's videos on YouTube of, there was some, I don't know, what he, some sort of He wasn't just a blogger. But he went out there, he went out to, onto the, you know, Venice Beach or whatever, and started asking people about, you know, who we fought in World War II. And who was, no, it was the revolution. It was the revolution. He asked who we fought in the revolution, and even more ridiculous questions, and people had no idea.
Fox News, it's O'Reilly.
I believe there was one
guy does
it. He had a heavy French accent. He was just visiting here, and he knew. He was a French
It was the foreigners. They were better at answering questions. The people don't know. They don't care. It's take care of it for me and send me a check or something.
You solved that problem. That
I think that's not about the judges.
Yeah.
Say that louder so we can hear it.
How do we can a judge?
Yeah.
Well, not how do we can. The question was, how do we determine if a judge should be can?
Well, this particular judge
should be can.
I've heard about always judging in favor of a certain type of party versus the other type of party.
Yeah. Part one, Article 30, part two, Article 38, which actually is an article that has no number because it's never been amended, and it is, and Article 39 is actually the last sentence in Article 38. Part two, so it's page 66. The Senate shall be a court with full power to an authority to hear, try, and determine all impeachments made by the House of Representatives against any officer or officers of the state. And because, in my interpretation, officers of the state, because the counties and towns are political subdivisions, would include officers and count of the counties and towns as well. They take the same oath as we do. Of the state for bribery, corruption, malpractice, or maladministration in office. And this is one of the important things about impeachment, is it's for actions in office. Bill of address is for actions outside of your office. Now, and this is another important distinction, that address is only for commissioned officers. Officers who hold a gubernatorial commission. So judges, the Commissioner of Health and Human Services, the Commissioner of Dred, those individuals hold gubernatorial commissions. Now, if you think of the military, that means there must be other officers, since impeachment does not make that distinction. There must be other officers who, though they cannot be removed by bill of address, can be removed by impeachment. I would consider that to really include any officer, okay, if you look at the military, commissioned officers are lieutenants, captains, etc., and you have non-commissioned officers, corporals and sergeants. So when our founders made the distinction that said any officer of the state, that would basically mean anybody who held supervisory authority. So department managers, directors, they are officers of the state who do not hold gubernatorial commissions. Now,
I'm sorry, Dan, where were you reading gubernatorial commissions?
Gubernatorial commissions is in Article 50. Where is it? Well, it's under the articles on bills of address. So it's over there, we'll find it later. So for bribery, corruption, malpractice, or maladministration in office with full power to issue summons or compulsory process for convening witnesses before them. But previous to the trial of any impeachment, the members of the Senate shall respectively be sworn and truly and impartially to try and determine the charges in question according to evidence. And every officer impeached for bribery, corruption, malpractice, or maladministration in office shall be served with an attested copy of the impeachment and an order of the Senate thereon, with such citation as the Senate may direct, setting forth the time and place of their sitting to try the impeachment. But service shall be made by the sheriff or other sworn officers as the Senate may appoint, at least 14 days previous to the time of trial on such citation. Let's see. And giving the person impeached, if he shall appear, the full liberty of producing witnesses, proofs, and making defense of himself, and may also, upon his refusing or neglecting to appear, to hear the proofs in support of the impeachment and rendering judgment thereon, his non-appearance notwithstanding, the judgment shall have the same force and effect as if the person impeached had appeared and pleaded in the trial. So that's how we convict. Now, if we, then Article 39 goes on, which is really part of the same paragraph. Their judgment shall, however, not extend further than the removal from office, disqualification to hold or enjoy any place of honor, trust, or profit under the state, but the party convicted shall nevertheless be liable to indictment, trial, and punishment according to the laws of the land. And then if we go back to the House of Representatives, the House of Representatives shall be the grand inquest of the state, and all impeachments made by them shall be heard and tried by the Senate. So we are the grand jury of the state. That's what grand inquest means. We are the grand jury of the state. If someone has a complaint, or a group of people have a complaint against a judge or judges, we hold the hearings to determine if we believe they should be impeached, and then we vote on impeachment or not. Ways that this could happen, typically, the way that's been practiced in the late 20th century, i.e. Paul Mirsky got judges Brock and Thayer impeached by the House. It happens, but they were not convicted by the Senate, by one vote, a lawyer. The House has a resolution, a House resolution. House resolution means the resolution does not go to the Senate. A House resolution is heard to investigate or to initiate an investigation on the particular individual. So in this case, in the case of a judge, it would probably go before the Judiciary Committee. I would argue it should not. That should go to some separate committee. But that resolution be voted on as to whether or not there was sufficient evidence that an investigation should be conducted. A positive vote on that would result in an investigation committee or the House Judiciary Committee being charged with the investigation of the alleged actions. Did they happen? What were the actions? Were there more actions? Originally, the impeachment began with Judge Brock, and in the course of the investigation, Judge Thayer was found, and the impeachment was brought against both. At the conclusion of the investigation, the committee, whatever committee it is, makes their case before the House. They produce a bill of impeachment, and that bill of impeachment is brought before the House and voted upon. If that bill of impeachment passes, then that is an indictment of the individual, and the trial is held in the Senate. Yes?
Clarification, and in that instance, Brock and Thayer were essentially...
They were impeached, they were indicted, but they were not convicted. They got off the hook. And in fact, in 2006, thank you.
Same as Clinton.
Well, but in 2000,
sure.
In about 2006 or 2008, Representative King got a bill passed that reimbursed them for their legal expenses. And his son got made a judge.
Seriously.
Would I kid you?
So they themselves were remunerated for the trouble?
Yes.
For their monetary trouble?
Yes.
And went back to work?
Probably they got a letter of apology.
They never left work. The impeachment was in 2000, it was in 1999.
Classy. But it went forward, at least it went forward.
It went forward. And they were impeached, just not convicted.
What were they impeached for?
Fixing divorce trials for each other. There was quite a practice in the judiciary of, you know, you expunge my wife, I'll expunge yours. Or maybe we should be more politically, you expunge your spouse, you expunge my spouse, I'll expunge yours.
That now it sounds like Strangers on a Train by Hitchcock, isn't it?
Yeah, I wasn't gonna go, I thought about it, and I didn't go there. our esteemed House counsel, though not indicted, was, I mean, that went on for a long time. House counsel.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was not part of that action, but he had a number of wives expunged.
That's the technical term.
Now, I have a bill in, because one of the things that I have observed is the House is not a good investigative body. I have a bill in that will create an Office of Ombudsman. It's great. And Ombudsman is actually a Scandinavian term, King's representative. It is the person to whom the people complain if they are aggrieved by government.
I didn't realize that there wasn't.
There is a Health and Human Services Ombudsman.
Huh. That's a different branch of government.
Yes. Well, the ombudsman that this proposes to create will be under the Secretary of State, who is elected by the legislature.
Yep.
Their function will be to hear, to receive criminal complaints against members of government and investigate them and return the results to the appropriate prosecuting authority.
So functionally, how would that differ from the House's redress committee?
The redress committee hears a complaint that may not be criminal.
Oh, this is criminal specifically?
Yes, they receive criminal complaints against members of government. Like the police officer who trespasses on your property and you can't get the local department to do anything about it.
So who investigates this?
The Ombudsman's office. The Ombudsman.
So they're going to have people with badges and guns?
I don't know about badges and guns, but they will have somebody who is actually an investigator. And the other function of this individual is to perform such investigations as requested by the legislature in support of impeachments or bills of address.
Badges? We don't need no stinking badges.
We don't need no stinking badges.
He has a badge.
The post is anticipated to be the same level of compensation that we receive plus expenses.
Wow.
Is there sufficient problems in the state?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
What's the likelihood of this would require a signature, yes?
Yes.
What's the likelihood?
Depends on who gets elected governor, doesn't it?
Well, it's not going to be the same one.
So basically, that is really to protect people and their local
community. Correct. County attorneys. The methodology is those who receive criminal complaints are police departments, sheriffs, and state police. And after having receive, done the initial investigation, they present the results to the police prosecutor, the county attorney, or the attorney general. But they have a track record of not adequately pursuing criminal complaints against members of government. Surprise, surprise. And Bill Gardner thinks it's a wonderful idea.
Yeah.
In fact, he came up with the term ombudsman.
Good. Did you say you have an idea for a bill, or that you have a bill in that you submitted earlier?
The bill was in this term. It was...
Not for next term. It was in this term.
It was in this term.
Okay.
It was the second year, and it was...
which committee? Retained?
Executive Department's Administration, and it was, what's the term? Not retained.
Moreover? Yeah.
What's the term for second year bills? You don't retain them, you...
No,
shoot.
I know, yeah.
Okay, where instead of going yay or nay, you further investigate them. And it has...
And never meet.
And it has, I didn't go to the executive session, it was on the 20th. But it came out of subcommittee as ought to pass.
So to
recommended for future legislation.
Yes. And then would...
And a number of serious substantive tweaks were made, from what I put in.
So presumably the next speaker would hand that off to a relevant committee.
Well, next speaker, a legislator will, pursuant to that recommendation, okay. The legislator will put in a bill that looks reasonably like what the committee recommended as a bill, and it will go go before the same committee, but this time they said, yeah, we want to do this, presuming they have a reasonably similar makeup.
Do you intend to do just that?
I certainly do. I didn't do it because I was waiting for the report to come out.
Would you like me to do that? Thank you. I will support that.
Look at you chuckling over there. Imagine people having the power not to be blown off.
Yeah.
So not asking.
It's like I want to take down the government or something.
Just want to put it back in its box.
It what?
Make it small enough that it can be drowned in a bathtub.
Make it small enough that it fits in the box.
I just want the cockroaches to see the kitchen light when I flip it on. See what they do.
Is this necessary because someone currently can't get satisfaction?
No, because the legislature doesn't deal out criminal penalties. Remember, when the legislature deals with a complaint against a member of government, they deal with the functionality. They deal with changes in the law. They may change the powers of the office involved. They may, this was really the result of the Redress of Grievances Committee. I mean, the first year we had 20-something petitions. I think they handled a total of something like 37 petitions. The majority of them involved the judiciary, and in particular the family court. What we learned was what the patterns of abuse were, which instructed us as to how to change the law. And we have effected some of those changes. Notable things that have passed as a result are that, well, I guess the only notable thing that's actually passed is that both parties to a, now let's see, in a divorce, both parties must submit a financial affidavit for any hearing involving financial matters, and the judge has to accept it, because strangely enough, we had a pattern where individuals, not both individuals would not be required to submit a financial affidavit. So one party would submit, you know, the whole skinny on where they were, and the other party wouldn't. And in, often in cases, particularly if individuals were self-employed, the judge would say, I don't believe it, and just substitute a different number. And so, as of July 2015, both parties have to submit it, and it has to be accepted unless there's evidence to the contrary. You can't arbitrarily say, I don't believe it.
I'm only kind of worried when legislation gets too specific. Isn't that kind of really calling down judges for, I mean, it's not their job to throw out an affidavit.
Correct. And we're telling them they can't.
In that particular case. I mean, yeah.
Okay. Until in the founding period, judges didn't make court rules except as instructed by the legislature. The legislature made the court rules. The legislature said what amounts of money could be charged for different types of contempt. I understand the depth of what has. Of how our perception of justice has changed. One thing is, in the founding period and into the 19th century, our courts were courts of justice. Remember, the first purpose of the state is to punish injustice. Our courts were courts of justice. They are now courts of law. Justice is a second issue. In dealing with issues of contempt, there was an attempt to put in a, despite the fact there are many laws that already define criminal contempt, there was a bill into dealing with contempt probably 10, maybe 15 years ago, and the response of the judiciary in their testimony was that contempt was an inherent power of the court. Now, our Constitution says that the House of Representatives can put an individual in jail indefinitely for contempt of the House of Representatives. The House of the Senate can only put an individual in jail for 10 days. The governor and the council separately only have the same powers of contempt as the Senate. Not one word is said about the courts having any power of contempt. Remember what I said? That which is included excludes all else. The fact that our Constitution enumerates our powers of contempt, the Senate's power of contempt, the Executive Council power of contempt, and the Governor's power of contempt, and gives no power of contempt to the judiciary, says the judiciary has no power of contempt. The only powers of contempt that they had were what we gave them in statute. They have now claimed an inherent power of contempt. I want you to think about what that means. If our rights are endued to us by our Creator, and we surrender certain of those rights to government via our Constitution. And the government has only those powers which we give it. And the judiciary claims an inherent power of contempt. What are they claiming? Divine right. They may not know what they're claiming, but that's what they're claiming.
It's good to be the king. It's good to be the king.
It's good to be the king.
So how do we argue against generations of precedent and their abuse of being able to defer to the tenants.
We introduce laws that restrain their powers of contempt. I do it regularly.
A lot of times
they don't like me for that.
I know, a lot of times it falls on deaf ears. It seems anachronistic to them. How do we overcome that?
And we teach.
Okay. In another word, I'm going to teach.
Yeah, I know. But it, in this context, it's teach. I mean, I have a bill that I put in the 2013-2014, and again the 2014-2015 session, that, and this again comes out of petitions for redress. We have a system where people go into court and there's an extended period of adjudication in a lot of divorce cases, especially when there's children involved. And you get to the end of the 6 months or the 9 months or whatever it is, and the ruling is given out, and the judge says, oh, you owe $1,000 a month of child support. And because this has been going on 9 months, you're $9,000 in arrears. Now,
you have a rich wife.
What they do, what happens is, how many people have $9,000 in the bank? Okay? How many people are just so angry that they just don't do it? But you end up having people put in jail for these instant arrearages of $10,000, $10,000, $20,000, $30,000. And there's no check that says that they can pay it. Now, one of the you have to understand the different kinds of types of contempt. Criminal contempt, somebody's put in jail for a term because they flipped the judge the bird. Okay? It is for a term. Civil contempt, on the other hand, is indefinite because there is a presumption in civil contempt that the individual has the keys to the jail. They're put in the civil contempt for failing to, you know, give a name and of you know, reporter refusing to give a name. Okay, but the reporter has the power to give the name, so they can get out of jail anytime they want. Civil contempt for these instant, enormous arrearages has included in it the presumption that the person can just write the check or whatever to get out of jail. And there are federal court opinions that say, and you can't require family members or require people to go into debt to pay that civil judgment.
Because that's debtor's prison.
Right. The bill that I have put in repeatedly now says, before you put somebody in jail for civil contempt, you have to have a finding of fact that they can satisfy the contempt. Pretty basic content. If you're going to assume they have the keys to the jail, make sure they have the key in their pocket. Thank you. It's failed twice, but this last term it failed by less than the term it failed by before.
What was the argument against it?
We don't want to take that power away from the judges.
That's it?
Oh, these people lie. They say they don't have the money.
They're deadbeats.
I have one woman who was literally traumatized by her experience. Now, she had been to district court regarding a vehicle that had a value, I don't know, like $12,000 or $9,000. And in the district court adjudication, she was given the title to the vehicle. Her ex-husband got this taken up afresh as a matter of the divorce and demanded that he pay her $12,000 or whatever it was for this vehicle.
She pay him.
She pay him. Okay. She got the car. He got the house. I thought he got the better of the deal anyway. But, and he had the kids. But.
So maybe she got the better of the deal.
Not gonna touch that one. So, So for failure to cough up the $12,000 or whatever it was, she got put into Rockham County Jail over a long weekend. And with the filth of the jail and everything else, she was literally traumatized. It was over Martin Luther King Day.
Well, that's how they plan those things.
Yeah, okay, and that's how she remembers. I mean, and to her, Martin Luther King Day is now a traumatic event. She was really severely traumatized by this event.
PTSD.
And, but then, lo and behold, after a week or so of this, they discovered that, you know what, she didn't have $12,000. I think they could have figured that out beforehand.
It's certainly before they planned the arrest warrant for Friday afternoon.
Right. A common tactic is to put somebody into jail for the whole amount and then progressively reduce it until they pay it. Or there are families who have paid these large arrearages, contrary to federal opinion.
Mine was one of them.
Okay. That's how we go about correcting this situation. But politics is a long game. That's the argument against the term limits. But politics is a long game.
But a personal life is not. And a personal life subjected to the long game of politics is not justice.
I agree with that, but we're already here.
Aren't we just?
You know, I mean, we're already here. It takes, you know, the ship of state is supposed to be going like this, and it's over here. We need a lot of tugboats to get it back on course. And a lot of people have been injured, and a lot of people are going to continue to get injured until we get it back on course. But we as legislators have the duty to implement these limitations on the other branches of government. I had a bill in to take away the governor's power to declare a state of emergency unless the legislature cannot be convened.
That was what, like 4 years ago? 5 years ago?
I think it was in the second year of, I think it was in 2014. No, it was in 2015 because it was after the governor did her drug war shuffle.
Get something and something. Wasn't there a similar bill after the flooding?
No. We actually did repeal the pop. What we repealed, it was something that passed in my first term. We repealed the delegation of powers of emergency to the agencies. We had given the powers of emergency either to Health and Human Services or to Department of Safety, I don't remember which. So it wasn't even gubernatorial, and powers to confiscate materiel from private individuals. And we repealed that in 2012.
Molon Labe.
And I requested of my colleagues and was allowed the honor of doing the parliamentary inquiry because I had been so incensed at the time it passed. And that I had been waiting 10 years to to have this opportunity.
This is in 2012?
Yeah.
At the end of the session?
At the end of the session year? No, it was about two. It would have been in the first half because it was a House bill.
HB?
Yeah.
I would love to see a recording of that. Yeah.
And I may mention the fact that I have been waiting to do this for 10 years. Thank you.
Just so you'll be able to get to sleep tonight, your bill will have the status of interim study.
Interim study. There we go.
Thank you.
That's
interim
it.
Study.
Thank you.
That's sleep. That's
in between terms.
The ombudsman was interim study, and as far as I anticipate, came out with recommendation for future legislation.
But it's often regarded as death with dignity, interim state.
Well, the John Sitek voted in favor of it.
Wow.
Because.
And the Democrat.
But because no matter whether it's you know should be as further study or not, that doesn't obligate the next legislation.
No, of course not. It's recommended for future legislation. So it is still the obligation of the interested parties to submit the new legislation.
Get what we do.
And to champion, of course.
Every step of the way. That's the trick.
Hey, I consider it a win. Now we gotta get through the Senate.
You gotta hold the House in the Senate.
How long did medical marijuana take for that, for example?
6 years.
And then how long did the executive branch drag its feet after it was, after
four
it
years?
Even signed it?
4 years.
Yep.
And still politics is a long game.
Lives are not.
I understand that. How many people died of various diseases? Before or spent their diseases in great discomfort before medical marijuana became a fact.
Mm-hmm. How long is it before neo-prohibition learns the lesson of the first prohibition? Still working.
Many before the 12th of never.
Many yeah. will not.
Many refuse to acknowledge that it's the same. Most people don't know drugs weren't illegal before 1970.
That's right. That's
true. There's a movie I enjoy. It's framed around Pearl Harbor. And bombers are being flown across the Pacific in anticipation of World War II, and their planned landing is in Pearl Harbor. And as they're approaching Pearl Harbor, they turn on the radios and you know they hear Pearl Harbor is getting attacked. And so they extend their flight plan. But as they're passing by Honolulu, they decide to listen to civilian radio. And one of the things is people who have opiates are encouraged to bring them to the naval base so that they can be put to the use of taking care of the
I've never heard that.
Oh yeah, which is implicit proof that people maybe. Had opiates at home.
What there were what opium movie? Dens.
Yeah.
What movie is that?
I don't know. I don't know the name of it, but it's just.
It's not widely played anymore, I'm guessing.
No, I don't think people connect the dots.
Yeah.